Let's talk about dark fantasy. Hey everyone, welcome back to my channel. My name is Brittany Simon and I'm feeling like an utter mess today. I feel like I look great, but I feel like a mess. And a big part of it is that I'm just really excited to do not only this episode, but the video I have coming up this week. I feel incredibly inspired and invigorated, and I'm stoked to start this podcast with you guys today. Thank you for listening on Spotify and thank you for being a part of Patreon. To my left, the tea of the day is actually a repeat of Empath's tea from the Witchwood Tea House on Etsy. It's this one right here. Cute, cute, cute packaging. I told you it's the one that reminded me of kind of like a tree. It's just very earthy, very simple. I like it a lot. So I'm going to go ahead and sip that to my left here. To my right, we've got a little bit of a show and tell for people watching on YouTube. I've got one of my favorite floggers from Firebird Leather. I don't know if you guys know, I've done a couple of reviews for them that are now on Patreon, but they're a wonderful company. They did not sponsor me. I just chose to buy from them. My friend Evie Lupine, who's a BDSM educator on the platform on YouTube and on Patreon, she actually introduced me to them. And so I've been buying from them ever since. They are wonderful. They've sent me things for free. They've been absolutely loving towards me. I saw them at Kinkfest. When did we go to Kinkfest? Shoot, I just, you know, I can't recall. But it was a few years ago, you know, way before COVID. And so Evie and I and a few others went to Kinkfest, saw Firebird Leather. Really nice. They've always been kind to me. So I wanted to pull that out for today's, episode. And as well as the notebook I have for my notes as per usual, but a book called Exquisite Corpse. This is by Poppy C. Bright. You guys have heard me talk about Poppy C. Bright in the past. They're one of my favorite horror authors. I found them when I was a teenager, about 18 or 19, right out of high school. I basically was an emo loser nerd in high school, and I was a part of theater, and I read all the time, and I wrote extra essays every week for my writing teacher so he could help me become a writer one day. And I've had an up and down relationship with writing, but one of the people that really changed how I saw the world was Poppy Z. Bright, because they wrote such horrific and detailed and honest and raw books. And in this podcast, I'm going to share a passage from one of their stories, and it is graphic. It is explicit. I'm going to mark this explicit on Spotify just so people know in advance. But this is also my life. I am a dark fantasy person, but I've also lived a life that has made me have to interact with people that are very different and possibly uncomfortable for most people. I do like horror authors. I like the life of a person who's in one way disturbed, but in another way aware. And I think this balance is where we draw the line between reality and fantasy, is often people who are disturbed can be often threatening to our lives. But at the same time, there are other people, I think people that I identify as myself, who identify or have parts of them that are monstrous, but we are not monsters. I do not live my life in a monstrous way. I try to live my life in a very ethical and moral way based off of the value system that I've created and stick to. I've been very transparent with that value system. Many of you have talked to me on Patreon. You know how I conduct myself. A lot of you have been inappropriate with me. You see how I conduct myself. I'm not, you know, confused or worried or ever feel violated when people are inappropriate with me, because I know how to handle it now. In the past, I would get defensive and feel awful and violated. But now I realize, like, oh, people don't often mean to be the way that they are. They think, based off of their understanding of the world, this is love and affection. And so it's my job as a person who is well-read, or somebody who prides herself in being well-read, as somebody who is also more compassionate because I know better. In the last podcast, I talked about how In the video I did about like pride and kink and overlapping our communities, I talked about how I know better. And because, I'm sorry, my freaking brain just remembered it's the borderline episode. I don't want people to get confused. Thank you for following my train of thought. Welcome to my head. I don't edit the podcast as much as possible, so you're just going to have to deal with this little, you know, mistake here. But it was the borderline episode I did about Jordan Peterson. I talked about how, as a person who has borderline, I'm going to sneeze. Hold on. Didn't I tell you guys I feel like a mess today? This is what I'm talking about. I feel like a mess. Okay, so in that episode, I did talk about how, as a person who's been diagnosed with borderline, and because I know better, because I'm well-read, it is now my job to make better decisions. I don't blame people who don't know better, who make decisions, but I inform them that their actions have impacts, and so they have to make a decision about how they want to impact the people around them and if they want to make better decisions. Because I know better ahead of time, before I've made any mistakes in relation to these newfound understandings of existence, I now have to do better. I think a lot of people in the comment section of that video were like, worried that I was condemning people outright, but I'm never ever condemning basically anyone outright. And I think the reason I don't condemn people outright is because I know ultimately the journey that I've been on. And I know ultimately that my journey hasn't been as insane or crazy as some people's, but it's close enough for me to understand, I think, very normal people and very weird people. I feel like my life has been a perfect balance, and a big part of that has been my curiosity into dark fantasy and love expression. You know, right now I'm doing a lot of research for this James Franco video I want to make, and I'm watching Interior Leather Bar, and it's so interesting to see these people have conversations, or there's a scene where James is seeing BDSM for the first time and he's like, whoa, I am shocked. But also I'm aware that I've been conditioned to think this is shocking. I actually think that's a very wrong way to think about it. I think a lot of people do think like BDSM is really normal, and if you just think about it the right way, it's really normal. Sort of, kind of, but not really. And that's why I have an issue as a truly like a person who wants to go down a path of like playing with fire. I have an issue with people thinking BDSM is normal, because in my head I'm like, oh, then we're not having the same thoughts, because the thoughts I have like aren't really normal in any particular way that I can identify them, unless you think it is normal to want to humiliate your lover and make them lick the dirt off your boots. I'm pretty sure that's not normal, right? And at the same time, it's not so outrageous that it needs to be villainized, and it doesn't need to be ostracized. So I think the issue with our communities is we're trying so hard to appeal to normies that we're forgetting ourselves through that path, through that journey. There's so many people who want validation from their oppressors or validation from the people who hate them. And I understand that. I'm just telling you, it's not the path to joy. The path to joy is accepting and tolerating the people around you and knowing where they come from and understanding your enemy to the point where you have to humanize them. That's what I think the ultimate path of enlightenment is being able to humanize everyone, even the worst of us, and then being able to make a truly reasonable decision about how to handle them, because it's not about letting people off the hook. So, okay, now that I've like said all that, because what I'm about to read is going to be very confusing for people. Remember, I am not a person who sees the world in black and white. Though how people have to interact with me might seem black and white, I don't see the world that way. And I'm not talking about this whole everyone's ethical because everyone's themselves either. I think there are some things that are objectively good and bad. I just think it's very hard to pinpoint what they are, and I don't think there are very many things. So what I'm about to read to you right now is a passage from Poppy Z. Bright's book, Exquisite Corpse. It is page 121, according to this print. And I highly recommend going to used bookstores and supporting local businesses. That's where I try to get all my books. And if you're lucky, you'll be able to find some Poppy Z. Bright. That's where I found her the first time I found her. Oh, I'm sorry, him. So I need to preface this with Poppy Z. Bright, when I knew them, was identifying as a woman, but actually transitioned later in their life to what I believe they now identify as a man. I could be wrong if it's non-binary or a man, but right now, as far as I know, they are identifying as a man. The reason this is important is because at the time I had read Poppy Z. Bright, I had noticed she had a fascination at the time. I know I'm pronouncing incorrectly. Just bear with me, people. Try not to judge me so quickly. So at the time, I was under the impression she was a cis woman writing about gay men's lives. This is very important because Poppy Z. Bright, much like Anne Rice, has a fascination, much like a lot of women in dark fantasy, even Laurel K. Hamilton, has a fascination with gay male relationships, feminine men, men who are comfortable in their bodies, men who are willing to fuck men and still be straight. There's something very distinct and unique about these women being attracted to not only dark fantasy, writing dark fantasy, living dark fantasy, but being obsessed with gay men and gay culture, because there's sort of a sexual liberation that exists in gay communities that I think straight women want. And in this case, this trans man found interesting. So just bear that in mind, because Poppy Z. Bright writes a lot about gay relationships. Okay, I'm going to blink out some of the words that are too much for YouTube. Sorry, that's just life. And we'll go on. He found himself on top of Tran, straddling the boy's narrow hips, the head of his easing into the tight heat of Tran's ass. Put it in, Tran begged, rocking under him. How easy it would be to plunge into this slick sleeve of muscle and membrane, to lose himself in that welcoming maze with no thought for the consequences. Maybe he could do it. Maybe Tran was the one boy who could survive his orgasm. Maybe it would be nice to share an afterglow with someone who still breathed. Jay felt his eyes blur with tears. He wanted Tran to stay alive. He wanted that so much. He never used to want his lovers dead. In the beginning, he had only wanted them to stay with him, and it seemed like no one would. not if given a choice in the matter. Somewhere along the way, control became a pleasure in itself. Then it became the main pleasure. He drugged boys and took pictures of their slack, helpless bodies and stared into their unknowing faces as he strangled them. Eventually, strangulation wasn't enough. He wanted them to react, and he began waking them up before they died, hurting them a little, then hurting them a lot. He fell in love with the insides of their bodies, found that he preferred them to the outsides. But for all of his desire to worship trans insides, there was equal longing not to hurt him at all, to slide into him and move with him and make him feel good, to hold him afterwards and listen to him breathing, to bask in his warmth that would not leach away. Jay, fuck me. The trans slid his hands down to Jay's and tried to pull Jay forward into him. Jay slid in a little deeper. Tran groaned, a hoarse, wildly erotic sound. And Jay understood without a doubt that he had penetrated Tran's body in this way. He wouldn't stop until Tran was split wide open. He made a conscious decision to stop, something he had never done before. It took every ounce of his will to make himself pull back, pull out. Luckily, his reserves of will were considerable. I can't possibly fuck you, he told Tran. You really ought to leave. Tran's face was a study in shock. His eyes glittered back with tears of frustration. What do you mean you can't fuck me? He demanded. I just can't. I'm not in the mood anymore. Forget it. He pulled the condom off his softening, deposited it into a sticky little heap on the nightstand, and lay waiting for something else to happen. If nothing did, he could easily lie here all night. A lovely numbness was beginning to steal over him. His bones felt soft, his tissues steeped in liquid opium. He thought of Tran's legs drawn up, offering himself. He thought of Luke, a bulky, faceless figure, on top of Tran as he had just been treating that poor kid right, screwing him deep and hard, giving him everything he wanted and maybe a little bit more. Neither image affected Jay at all. Something brushed his hand, Tran's fingers, sweaty and timid, sliding into his grasp. It's okay, Tran said. Let me know if you change your mind. Maybe we can get to know each other a little bit better. Right, thought Jay. I'm sure you'd be thrilled if you really got to know me. Saw how I spend my evenings, met some of my friends. But he only said, maybe so. Tran sighed. Look, I hate to ask, what? Can I still stay here just for tonight? I really don't have anywhere else to go. Sure, I'll sleep on the couch if you want. Don't worry about it. Jay realized he had no longer felt any attraction to Tran. Though he liked having the little lithe, warm body in his bed, he had turned off those feelings and there was no danger now. Hurting Tran at this point was no more likely than ripping his pillow to shreds. The boy was only a comfort, a fleeting one that would be gone tomorrow. Okay, so obviously forgive me for my reading because I do not read out loud often and I'm slightly dyslexic and it just takes my brain a little bit. So I hope that translated correctly. So, oh my gosh, I love this passage. This book is so good to me. Like, I love it so much. I have so many fond memories of it. And here I was reading it as, like, an older teenager, but a young person in general. And I was trying to understand, like, the thought process of this person. This main character, this main idea of Jay and who he sees himself as and how he treats men, especially Asian men. Like, the book is very dark to read. I mean, it not only covers, like, issues of, like, transness and gayness and Asianness and people of colorness and, like, all of these things, but it talks about this idea of a person who lives in a world where their desire to be loved became suffocating. We see this often, and I think this is the issue with dark fantasy, is that a lot of people who desire dark fantasy overlap with a lot of people who desire love, period. And love, when it comes from a place of neediness and desperation, is poisonous in the same way that it can be toxic when it comes from a place of pain and hurt. And it's so interesting to me that for some reason Americans too really struggle with sexuality. They just really struggle with understanding the darkness of a person's psyche in relation to sex, and also the shallowness and basicness of sex. I mean, the way that people react to the desire people have just to have sex and go is amazing to me. And I see it everywhere. You can try to make it political, but if you listen to my work, you know I do not believe there's a correlation between sex, meaning male or female, meaning men are not more likely to be violent or sexual deviants as much as women are. Not truly. The narcissism rates, the things in which we express ourselves may differ in terms of how we do things, but that desperate need for love can be found in all people of all shapes and sizes. And I think this idea we've created in the world to find answers by polarizing someone different from us has stunted us. And this includes sexually deviant people, Puritans, really religious people, the way I was raised. There's such a fear of taboo sex for two reasons. One is just the moral implication of your religion, the idea of sinning, right, and going to hell. And then the other one is the real knowledge that there are really bad people in the world who happen to like these things. And so the question we're always asking ourselves in culture is, the reason we like these things because we're bad people, or are these things appealable to all kinds of people, good or bad? And then what is this concept of good and bad we're even battling out with each other? Okay. So as we proceed forward, I think the thing that's super key in understanding our differences is knowing why we're even going there as individuals. I've told you so many times, right, that I've asked people in BDSM, like, why are you here? And it's amazing how many people go, oh, I'm not really sure. I just kind of showed up. And I'm like, oh, okay. And then some people who are like, I just wanted friends of any kind. And I'm like, okay. And then other people I meet, we see each other, we understand each other. You know, there was sort of this sort of irony, I think, to BDSMers. When I went to BDSM dungeons frequently before COVID shut down, I used to go to all age parties and TNG parties. TNG parties are the next generation. Hold on, I need some tea. I felt my throat getting itchy. Okay, so I used to go to TNG parties, the next generation, and then there were, of course, all age parties. These are different. The TNG movement is great. I'm glad that it exists. I like TNG. Some of my friends have done boards on TNG, have been a part of BDSM dungeons, have definitely been volunteers, things like that. TNG is 18 to 35, and usually if your partners age out, you can continue going to events if you have a partner that's younger. But if you're not, you respectfully give young people a chance to get to know people their own age before getting into all party BDSM parties. I didn't need this. When I first came into BDSM, I went to all age parties. I didn't even think about going to TNG. I didn't even know it existed. My mentor was in her 50s at the time. People I played with were in their 50s and 60s. For me, it's not about the age. It's about your experience. It's funny. Young people are always creeped out sometimes when I meet them about older people hitting on them at the dungeons. And I always think that's so funny because older people have the experience and wisdom to play with you safely, while younger people might not have that experience. And it's funny that they trust them. But on the flip side, their concern is that older people will be manipulating younger people to sort of have fun with younger people. And I suppose I see that less in some parts of BDSM and more in others. Because I practice non-sexual BDSM traditionally, I don't really roll with a lot of people that are focused on that. And so the body type doesn't matter. I think it's also, you need to acknowledge why you're there. If you're at the dungeon to have sex, which is fine, no judgment, but it's definitely not what I'm there for. But if you're there for that, that means you're attracting people who want to be physically aroused. And so you're going to find people who, yes, find younger people more appealing in general, because you have to do traditionally less to look pretty, because your bodies are ripe and tight and small and young. You know what I mean? But in BDSM communities, because we're so welcoming and tolerant, we also find beauty in all shapes and sizes. And so it's a little bit hard to, I guess, find your place in the community if you think it's always one way. It's different. The community is vast and wide and has kinks I've never even heard of, fetishes I've never even thought to exist, right? There's always going to be people we don't know about. And so you need to be aware of how much do you actually know, how much are you assuming, and don't assume everyone's there because of why you're there. And then you have to know the why to pick out the right partners in general, to find the distinction between the people who might kill you and the people who are just there to have fun and basically pretend to almost kill you. So in preparation for this episode, I actually did talk to one of you. I had asked you guys a while back to collab with me on some ideas, some videos you wanted to see me talk about. And one of you, hey girl, hey, thanks to Ashley for helping me do this. Okay, so we talked about dark fantasy. It was so great. What a lovely conversation. And I wrote down some notes, some examples of like generational differences as well. But the cool thing about this person is that we both read Laurel K. Hamilton and we belong to dark fantasy, fan bases in different ways. So the cool thing about it is that I'm able to talk to someone about these authors. I know that sounds crazy, but these authors are New York Times bestsellers. They have fandoms, but these fandoms don't necessarily all overlap, and we're not there for the same reason. We're not reading these books for the same reason. But in particular, the Laurel K. Hamilton Laurel K. Hamilton, her Anita Blake and Mary Gentry series really stands out to us because it's BDSM, it's magic-y, it's modern, but it's fantasy. It involves challenging LGBT norms, women's sexuality norms. It started in the 80s by Laurel K. Hamilton, who's actually a big fan of Robert B. Parker. Robert B. Parker is my favorite male author because he's just so quick-witted and fast. He's got a character named Spencer out of Boston, and I started reading those books when I was a teenager. I was like 16, I think, when I started reading Robert B. Parker. It was like the summer I just turned, or maybe I just turned 15, but either way, I was kind of young, and they were recommended by a teacher who is still one of my best friends today, who, you know, likes to edit my writing and tell me how bad it is, because I have so much work to do. But one of the cool things about that relationship was that I had an adult to talk to about that fiction. When I started getting into dark fantasy, though, it became harder to talk to my high school teacher about it. And I was like, I need people to talk to. And no one was reading the books I was reading. So I relied heavily on MySpace and forums and FetLife and places I could go to who could help me understand what I was reading. But still, I struggled to find people who were there for the same reason I was. And then I found people who were. And the conversations we're having are so much different. So we were talking about this one book Laurel K. Hamilton has with Anita Blake where she has a moment where basically it's a werewolf situation. You know how it goes. And a ritual starts. And basically all the male werewolves have to fuck her to get to power. And I know a lot of people are like, oh, this is just an excuse to have like a rape scene or a C&C fantasy. C&C being consent, not consent. And yes, no. There are so many elements of BDSM that show up in Laurel K. Hamilton's writing before she even came out as poly in BDSM. Because, of course, she started writing in the 80s. She was writing a really strong-voiced, arrogant, stubborn female protagonist. There was a lot of reasons her books maybe wouldn't have stood a chance. But they really did. They found a community. So in this scene, you know, Anita's running away. She's trying to get to a safe place. Some of the werewolves who know her are trying to protect her basically from getting fucked by the wrong person. Because basically if she gets fucked by any of these guys, it is rape. But to those men, it's more or less about business. It's not personal. It's not something they can even control. There's magic involved. And it's interesting because a lot of people might feel, especially in today's climate, like, oh no, this is glorifying rape. But for me, it's an opportunity to live out a fantasy in a position where you are the man out. You are outnumbered. I think a lot of us live very safe and comfortable lives, and that's wonderful and that's beautiful, and I don't think you should want to live a life that's hard. But I do warn you that when you live a life in general, it tends to be hard because life is hard. So just make sure you're not seeking out like a heroin addiction to be cool and edgy, and make sure that if you do have a life in which you, oh my gosh, find yourself all of a sudden addicted to heroin, you are not destroyed, that you know you can come out of this and you can make this something that it doesn't define your whole life in any more than this moment. Because remember, I heavily believe that my traumas and everything were moments of my life, but they do not carry forward with me because I have, in my opinion, healed to such an ability or such a way with my illnesses that for me, they seem like almost just it's a person I forget that existed almost, but I still love her and live with her. So that person loved this writing because she found power in these situations, ways to get out of circumstances in which she felt trapped. Now I read them and I'm comforted by sort of the ways that I've utilized these skills throughout my life. I cannot explain to you how many life and death situations I've been in just being in bad situations with bad people in which I know for a fact I got out of those situations because of the books I've read. Just circumstances in dark seedy clubs or, you know, you're the only girl in a group full of very intoxicated men and you're wondering like, oh, is this my fucking moment? You know, it's so funny because I think a lot of people assume that good people don't have thoughts that cross their minds in obvious situations of, ooh, do we need to address this? But I think it is so clear that when you're in those situations, all you're thinking is like, oh shit, is this my moment? Even if previously being in that situation might have felt safe, sometimes things change, energies change, things shift. Do you know how many house parties I went to when I was younger? Do you know how many times I've been drunk off my ass? How many times I've been on top of people I didn't know? How many times I've been in circumstances in which everything went fine and then one night it didn't and there was two men who came at me? Like, do you understand that I had played with fire for so long and not gone burned until I did multiple times. And I was like, oops, learn that lesson. Oops, learn that lesson. You know, life offers you opportunities to learn. And sometimes you have to vicariously learn through dark fantasy. But what makes a person want to live out that dark fantasy? My best friend of 20 plus years is quite literally the most opposite of me. She is very much an Orange County girl. We grew up in Orange County. That's where we met each other until my parents moved me to the country at 15. And I was alienated from all my city friends and I became a book nerd. That's literally why I picked up reading, because I had none of my friends with me. So I was like, I'm alone. And then my friend group at school ostracized me because, you know, women are crazy, like legit, like they have issues, as do men, as do humans. So remember, like, I have an equal amount of pain given to me by women and men. I'm not under the illusion that there's quite a difference in us. But how we go about things is different and unique, and that's what's interesting. So why do girls especially love dark fantasy? Why do they like being put in situations where it feels like CNC? And why do I like it, but like my best friend doesn't, even though we're both women, and even though there are studies that have been done about women's attraction to sort of these stories? Even 50 Shades of Grey, my best friend had read it, and she came to me and said, oh my god, is this what you do at the dungeon? Is this what BDSM is? And I was like, no, that's like a fantasy version of BDSM versus like what's really happening in BDSM. Plus, BDSM isn't actually the focus of those books. It's more like Christian's trauma in relation to BDSM. So you have to imagine, right, when I'm talking to my best friend about these things, when she's trying to figure out, you know, how do you feel so comfortable like flirting with people? And like, I mean, you have to understand, I'm so much more extroverted compared to her, but a lot of it is because she's shy and I'm not. Like, our personalities were very similar. We chose careers that are very similar. We're very similar in terms of our value systems. But because she's shy and I'm not, I never think about dating as like a scary thing. But for her, she's more like private. And so it's like the idea of hitting on a man at Target would be outrageous. But for me, I'm like, yo, what up, boo, me, you. You know what I mean? It's just different. But also, if you looked at us, you would say she's like a good girl and I'm like a whore. And so that's sort of like the funny irony as well, is that maybe the reason I'm attracted to dark fantasy is because on a spectrum of what interests people, I land on the spectrum of like dark and seedy and kind of like improper. And she lands on one that's like proper and beautiful and clean. And it's very interesting that we have been able to maintain a friendship even though we've been so different. And a big part of that is understanding each other. When she finds out I'm reading dark fantasy and I'm telling her all the details, like, bro, this book is about a serial killer who kills twinks. Like, she's like, that's interesting. You know, we've grown up watching cult films. Her parents are very liberal. And so they introduced me to a lot of like, you know, just films that as growing up conservative, I just never would have been introduced to. You know, things like Boogie Nights and things like this. Like, we just, Requiem for a Dream. Like, we're watching these really intense, weird, awkward sex scenes with each other. But it's all about being critical about what you're seeing. And what's so funny is that we all have different perspectives from it. I remember one time her dad, we were watching, there was a news story out. And they were talking about BDSM and how there was like a parade or a march happening in San Fran. And my friend's dad was reading a newspaper and he's very smart and he knows for a fact that I'm just like this mess on the internet because I'm like his second daughter. And he just like, my parents have a don't ask, don't tell policy. Like, I don't, you know, they don't ask about my work. I don't talk about it. That's how I prefer it. But her dad goes, so Brittany, you know anything about that BDSM stuff? And at the time I was a BDSM educator on YouTube making a living that way. And I like looked at him and I gave him a side eye and I was like, who, me? I have no idea. And he goes, oh, really? And I was like, well, what do you know that I don't know? And like, it's just one of those things where we looked at each other and it's like, it's not that I'm lying to him because he doesn't really want the answer, but he wants me to know that he knows the answer. And it's so funny because like, it's sort of like witty versus like her mother who would just like never have this conversation with me. She'd be like, like her mom just found out what OnlyFans is and God forbid she finds out I'm on it. But like the dad, like the way he knows about the world is just so different. It's not that he's a dark fantasy person, but he's well-versed in knowledge. And I think this is the thing, too. He's not completely shocked about the world. When you live a life where you're shocked constantly about the world, yeah, seeing BDSM leather for the first time must be crazy. I remember when I first went to the dungeon, and like I was 21, and I had been reading about BDSM, but didn't really know it was true until my mentor took me in. And when I went there, I felt so comfortable after a while, like just so at home. At first I was like, oh my god, I've never been naked, I'm a virgin, what do I do? And then as I'm running through the dungeon just meeting people who are naked and having normal conversations, I'm like, oh, this is dope though. Like, I had so much fun at my first party. Everyone was so respectful, everyone was so sweet. This was just before 50 Shades of Grey hit the market, the first book. And it was such a good, wonderful, close-knit, very weird group of people. A lot of psychologists, a lot of accountants, a lot of grocery workers, a lot of teachers, a lot of just normal people. Just like normal, everyday people. You know, no eccentric, weird billionaires trying to come in and make a name for themselves. Just normal people being abnormal. Because, and I know to be BDSM, I do believe you have to be weird. But I also believe there's like a normal weird to us. Like, I think BDSMers are some of the most harmless people I've ever met. But BDSM is a fantasy. It's not real, but it needs to be played out as if it's absolutely real in order for it to feel real. And I think some of us do tote the line. Like, I knew a woman who used to do waterboarding at the dungeon. There's no way to really fake waterboarding. So she is really waterboarding people. And it's just interesting that it's hard to explain that to normie people who have, you know, we've worked so hard to get Guantanamo Bay shut down because they waterboard people, or it's torturous. Christopher Hitchens did this whole journalism thing where he chose to volunteer to be waterboarding, and he said it was the worst experience of his life. I've known people at the dungeon who are like, this was awful. And then other people who are like, this was a thrill, a chance for me to meet death, a thrill, a chance for me to meet myself. I'm claustrophobic. I've also been assaulted, in which my face being covered was a big part of it. So for me, I don't think I'm ever going to be able to really get waterboarded. But God, there is a part of me that really wants to try. I really want to challenge myself in this way. I want to see that part of death in that way. I'm not afraid of dying. I find it to be interesting and freeing and comforting knowing that I'm going to die. Knowing that if I wanted, I have the choice of how I want to die, or knowing that I'm going to live a long, statistically healthy life given my genetics and like my grandparents, you know, longevity. And I feel confident in that. But at the same time, my obsession with death isn't really dark anymore. It's kind of more just like comfortable, like a friend. You know, you're just like, hey, buddy, are we going to chill today? No? Okay, I'll see you in 50 years maybe. It's very different. But I remember thinking of all the people who have felt shocked at the dungeon. Like, I'm literally, like I told you, watching Interior Leather Bar. And James Franco was literally talking about, like, oh, man, I was so shocked, right? I was so shocked. And there's something about the way James Franco's brain works that I can tell he's trying so hard to find something deep and meaningful in life. But to be completely honest, I think, like, at this stage of filming, he's like many other people who are looking for that depth. They're looking for it in extreme lifestyles in hopes that it will give them an insight into humans. But even people in extreme lifestyles can be basic. Even people who write dark fantasy can be basic. I see that a lot on Literotica. I'm like, y'all are trying to be so dark, but you're kind of like so basic. So how do we go through filtering that out? Well, I wrote some of my notes down. Literotica, Quizilla, Tumblr, online websites that allowed a lot of women especially to write a lot of really dark fantasies. I remember one on Quizilla, and I swear to God, if the woman who wrote this is in my audience, I will worship you. I just loved this story as a teenager. It was on Quizilla. It was starring a Brianna and an Eric, and he was a vampire, and she was like at her house, and her parents were away, and then he kidnaps her because his dad is Dracula, and he needs a bride, but he doesn't want to choose another vampire. He wants to choose a human. He can just like do something with and control, and then he uses a feather to give her an orgasm, and then he pulled it away before she came, and it felt like a rock dropping from between her legs. That is the most distinct thing I remember. Oh, and she went wandering around his castle, and she got trapped with a man who was like torturing her, and then he tortured her because he had to show her through punishment not to hurt herself. Very interesting. The reason it's interesting is because, like, I'm reading the story, right? A girl gets kidnapped, automatically scary, right? And if this was happening in real life, holy fuck, scary. Second, the man has magical powers to use and abuse her body how she wants. Oh my God, so scary. In a fantasy world, so sexy. There's a part in the story where, like I told you, she goes down into a part of the room she's not supposed to, i.e. Beauty and the Beast, when he catches Belle trying to look at his flower, you know. And he's like, get out! So Eric finds Brianna, like, fucking walking around his castle, his domain, his dark fantasy castle. And he's like, girl, now I have to torture you to show you why you're not supposed to come down here. Very BDSM. There's something about BDSM that really confuses vanilla people. And that it's the idea that masochism and sadism can be used as a love language. It's the idea that all sadists are individuals. In BDSM, we do not make the assumption that if you're a sadist, you're a good person. There's so much misinformation on Twitter, which, you know, it's not the fault of the 14-year-olds, but they'll go online and they'll say, well, the man, you know, anyone who's a sadist is awful. Or they'll say, well, he's a sadist, which means he's a part of BDSM, which means he's safe. No, sadism just means you like hurting people, and masochism means you like getting hurt, like pain traditionally. And how that happens is going to be so subjective to the people you're interacting with. So some could say that in the fantasy world of Eric and Brianna, like, he loved her enough to torture her, to remind her not to do something that will hurt her more. kind of like a parent and a child. Or some could say, wow, he could have just explained it to her. She's not an idiot. But that's not really a part of the fantasy, is it? Because in real life, we wouldn't have operated in any way similar to the fantasy world, because that would have been insane. And so you have to act differently in the fantasy than you would in real life, because the fantasy is allowing you to. So much of dark fantasy is revolved around power. Power dynamics, the strength of what do you do when you're trapped. I remember in the Mary Gentry series, also written by Laurel K. Hamilton, Mary Gentry, she's like Fae and a princess, but she's also human. And she struggles with living in these two identity worlds, living in like, what are my options? She has little to no option. You know, I always say I don't want to be famous and I don't want to be rich because I don't want rich people problems or famous people problems. It's not worth it to me. The only benefit to being famous is you maybe get money, but money is accessible to people without getting famous. You do not need to get famous to have money. And then, of course, like, you know, being recognized and validated, I don't give a fuck about the outside world validating my work, right? Because like, I'm not here to work for the outside world. My work isn't going to make sense to most people. My work is literally for people like me. And I'm not like most people, but I'm like enough people, right? Like enough people. I definitely don't feel alone in the world. I just feel selective in every capacity, right? So here I am in love with these dark fantasies, reading about Mary Gentry, reading about the responsibility factor. So Anita Blake, the difference between Anita and Mary is Anita is only responsible for herself and then eventually for the people she chooses to love and open up to. Well, Mary is automatically responsible for two kingdoms. She has responsibility politically, emotionally. She has to have sex with people out of obligation, but, you know, sees it as an act of service, which is very interesting. She has to deal with family politics. In the world of Mary Gentry, which I love so much, people don't lie in the Fae kingdoms. They are so good with their words that they can tell a lie without telling a lie. I admired this when I was younger. I was like, oh, I'm going to try to do that. And so I have moved through my life with the decision. I've decided that a part of my value system is don't lie. But another part of my value system is don't be a fool. So if you're in a position in which lying would help you survive, in some ways it could be ethical, but I try not to lie. So I can live within my values while still not sacrificing my safety. And that's very difficult to do. It's actually been a challenge throughout my existence and I haven't perfected it yet. You know, I try very hard not to lie. If I feel like I'm going to have to, I usually just say, you know, I'm not going to answer that question. And that takes a lot of confidence in like, I'm not going to give into this. And then that means you have to allow people to make assumptions about you. Because remember, that's what people are doing anyways. And when you stay silent, that's what people will do more. But sometimes being silent is better. Okay, so Mary Gentry, kind of the adult. Anita Blake, kind of the child. Because again, a child only has to worry about themselves. Adults have to worry about a lot of things. Hopefully, traditionally. Okay, now there's the Anne Rice perspective. So Anne Rice ended up writing the Sleeping Beauty series, which she later on regretted after she reconverted back to Catholicism or Christianity and wrote the Jesus stories and everything. But I think, you know, Anne will admit that there was a time and a place for these writings. And even though she herself as an author might not feel as connected to them, though I'm sure she does in many ways, I can understand how she got there. I can also understand how she got where she is now. I like Anne Rice. I love Laurel K. Hamilton. I like Robert Parker. Everyone I'm naming, I do really enjoy their writings. And if it might appeal to you, I do recommend them. But Anne Rice, also a straight woman with obsession about men and men's affection towards each other, wrote, as you guys know, Interview with the Vampire, Lestat and Louis. But she also wrote, like I said, the Sleeping Beauty series. And this is, you know, if you guys know the original Sleeping Beauty kind of story, she's basically raped, impregnated, and wakes up, I think, as she's giving birth, if I recall. And in this story, it's basically a play on that. And it's a play on heavy S&M. It's a play on heavy, just heavy, like, power dynamics. The premise of it is that they're slaves and taken and stolen and kidnapped and raped and hairbrushed and beaten until they're bloody and blue. But the thing is that there's sort of like one character that I recall very distinctly, the one I identify with, the brat, a person who she gets, you know, she's on a hard point in the ceiling. She's hanging from some bondage. I think it was a net, if I remember. Maybe she was just in rope. I don't remember. And as you guys know, of course, like I know rope, you know, I know riggers. I know people in BDSM. I've been suspended. I've done all these things, of course. But there's so many more things that I want to do, you know, throughout the next 30 years of my life in relation to this. But I remember this scene and she's getting spanked. And then they told her, like, follow in line. And then she was like, no. And she, like, rebelled again. She bratted. And so they beat her harder. And I'm not going to lie. Like, she was laughing and giggling. And, like, I have done this. I remember I was on a little, like, sawhorse. You know, I was roped. I was tied down. And the top at the time was spanking me, I think, with a paddle and yelling at me. And I was in the corner of the dungeon. And I am a brat. I also, at the time, was not healed from my traumas. And my partner at the time knew. And so we had, I think, healthier conversations about how to, like, navigate those moments. Like, I really need to be put in my place because I'm just, like, such an ENTJ, right? Like, not to be that person, but, like, hello. And so I'm so wanting to be in control all the time that the reason I play BDSM and I'm a bottom is because I'm a switch, but I'm a bottom is because I want the challenge of being in that position and feeling that power regardless of how I navigate around it. So I'm tied down. Was I blindfolded? I don't think so, but I was tied down. I was like on all fours straddling this sawhorse, and he turned around for a second, which was a mistake, and I picked up the sawhorse, which is very heavy and big. It's not like the ones you get at like Home Depot to work on your shops or something. It's a big leather one, gorgeous, and I picked it up and I scooted my way backwards into the dungeon floor, which, keep in mind, I don't want newbies to hear that and think that's always okay. It's not. You don't want to run into other people's scenes. So a big part of it is like heavily making sure the top is watching and then making sure the bottom knows not to go into other people's scenes. So I'm like definitely navigating, and I learned that the hard way. P.S. Okay, different story, but I learned that the hard way about walking into other people's scenes. You do not want to be that person. So anyway, so I'm walking backwards with the sawhorse, and I'm just like, nom, 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 nom. And then he finally grabs me, beats me harder for walking away. I know that to non-BDSM people, this all sounds outrageous, but to me, it's so fulfilling. I remember one of the first scenes I had with one of my tops at the time was we were at the dungeon. We're in the back room, and the back room had segregation, like through walls and tarps and things to make people feel more private and safe because it was the bed part of the dungeon. And I don't usually have sex at dungeons. I've done it a few times. I'm not an exhibitionist. Not really my thing. But if they have private beds and private rooms, I do feel much more comfortable being intimate with my partner in a setting in which hundreds of people are technically surrounding us but not watching us. So we went to this back room, and there was barely anyone at the dungeon, so we were the only ones in that room at the time. And he sat down on the bed, and we were still getting to know each other. Things were kind of like, eh. And, God, I don't know if I've ever told this story. Oh, I don't know. Okay, so he's sitting there. He's, like, wearing this kilt and this little button-up shirt, and he's got these boots on with these, you know, shin-high socks. Black socks. And, you know, I'm kneeling and he goes, take off my boots. And I take off his boots, and I love leather. I love boots. I love being stepped on. I love the smell of boots. I love it in my mouth. I love boots. I love cleaning boots. I love boots. And so, like, I'm like, okay. So I take off his boots. I put him on the side. He's take off my socks. I take off his socks. And then he goes, clean my feet. And I'm like, clean your feet. And he's like, clean my feet. And so something I pride myself in being is, and I'm not so great at it now, I'm definitely out of practice, but I love a little witty challenge. So I like it when my tops or doms give me a challenge that is a clear order, but isn't clearly how to do it. And then I have to figure out how to do it. It's really hard for me. I've definitely cried a lot through these scenes because I feel useless and I'm not smart enough to figure it out. But girl, that's my kink, is like trying to be smart enough to figure it out. So I looked around and I wasn't allowed to move. So I had to stay kneeling. And then he was like, clean my feet. And so my brain, here I am, this like, still just a couple of years into BDSM. I really still haven't explored a lot of it. And I go, okay. So my brain goes, oh, he wants me to lick his feet clean. And it's funny because a lot of people in BDSM don't necessarily feel comfortable negotiating in middle of scenes, but I do, because I don't like to know what's going to happen exactly, but I want an opportunity to trust myself to a safe word out. So I'm a big proponent of safe words. I think I've seen a lot of people make the argument that if you need a safe word in a scene, you're playing with the wrong people. And I think that's super fucking stupid and arrogant. I think it is a young person thing. I've never heard anyone in the dungeon up until Tumblr days justify not using a safe word in shaming people. I've just never had that interaction. I've never met people. My mentor gave me checklists. The way I was taught to do BDSM was so strict that, like, if you didn't say a safe word as a bottom, you are a bad play partner. Not, you know what I mean? You need to learn how to say your safe words. And some people have different experiences, whatever. praise be for you having those experiences, but I see them all from very inexperienced people who refuse to listen to their elders. And that, you know, girl, how much sympathy am I gonna have for you, really? So, okay. So I'm sitting there. I was doing this in my head. Do I safe word? Am I okay with this? How do I feel about this? Well, he simply just stared down at me and waited. And what he was doing by being silent was giving me a chance to think it over. Not silencing me, but making sure I was thinking about it. And so I just went, okay. And then I licked his feet clean. And it was really intimate and beautiful and wonderful. And I really enjoyed it. Yeah. There was something just really raw about it. And it's not about sexuality, right? Like at that moment, it wasn't about an orgasm. It was about following orders, having a little bit of humility, and having a sense of intimacy with a person that I hadn't really, that I was still building it with. This was just a play partner at the time. It was somebody that I eventually ended up dating, but it's also somebody that at the time, and this is so important, we were building intimacy together, and we were doing it by also building trust together in these scenes. And that's so intimate and beautiful. And on the same sort of, in the same vein, I've also had casual experiences with people that were intimate for that very moment we were having it. I think that's why BDSM is like a drug, because traditionally it's not done sober. I mean, sorry, traditionally it is done sober. So all of these beautiful intimate moments I've had were done sober, where I really connected with a person without drugs and instead used the chemicals, you know, in my body, those kinds of drugs, to connect with this person. BDSM is like that test people do where they stare at each other and ask each other questions to build intimacy quickly. That's BDSM, like, and that's why I get that young people or old people who have never done it, inexperienced people, jump into it, get enthralled in it, want to be a part of it. They see like a James Franco involving himself in BDSM and go, ooh, maybe it's normal, maybe it's hot. The thing is that it is not normal, but it is hot. And it feels normal when you're in it because everyone is like you when you're in it. But, you know, BDSMers got to be aware that, like, they're the odd man out. Even if masochism and S&M and BDSM in general is found amongst all cultures in different ways, BDSM communities and the way they run in the States or in other places, like, there is a vibe, right? There is, like, a vibe. Actually, interestingly enough, in the James Franco video, I'll talk about this a lot, but I like dark, seedy, dangerous feeling places that I know are ultimately safe. One of the things I love about the dungeons I've mostly played in is like they often have really dark walls, red walls, walls that make you feel like you're in a cage, but you're safe. It's not like black and dreary and dusty. Instead, it's like beautiful and gorgeous and clean and nice and expensive, but dark and like it's enveloping you, like in an embrace. Something about BDSM is very possessive and has to be, I think, for it to feel the way BDSM does or the way that we want it to feel, which is just very like dangerous but not dangerous. So funny enough, the issue that many people take with dark fantasies is that it will encourage bad behavior. But I think humans in general, when they're seeking out a specific thrill, choose bad behavior to seek it out. As an example, I'm at a munch, and a munch is just a gathering of BDSMers in a vanilla setting in vanilla clothing where we all just hang out and have pizza and talk about other things other than BDSM, really. So I'm chilling with a homie, and she goes, hey, I just had a great experience with a couple. And I was like, tell me about it. She goes, the other day I was at a munch, you know, much like this one, and full on, this couple comes in, they start flirting with me, I'm into it. They go, let me blindfold you and take you back to our place and do whatever we want with you. She's like, fuck yeah, that's what I'm into. They blindfold her, put her in a car, take her somewhere in Seattle, have their way with her. It ends up great. They end the scene. It's wonderful. Great story. And I looked at her with just like the most shocked face. And she goes, I know, I know. And I was like, girl, you could have been raped, kidnapped. You could have been sold over the border. There's so many bad things that could have happened to you. And she was like, I know, but I loved it. It was so much fun. And that's the thing. That's the hard part, right? Is a lot of us have these dark fantasies and we're hoping we come out of it alive so we can talk about it. But in order for the fantasies to feel as real as possible, we have to play with that line of, am I going to get killed tonight? Oh my God. And it seems really shallow and silly. And in parts it is. So one of the things I've observed about people who like dark fantasies is how they're observing them. Now, I do think if you review my philosophy system of the levels, right? And this is, again, the level system is a reflection upon a person's ability to understand their own existence in relation to all of existence, right? Like existence itself. It is not a moral indicator necessarily. It is not necessarily an intelligence indicator, more so as an ability. Like there is a type of intelligence you'll need to reach a 5, but it's not the kind you find in academia. And what happens is a lot of people in academia are a certain kind of smart. And so they assume they understand the human condition because they've read these books or done these studies. But the human condition, in my opinion, is lived. It is a lived condition. And so people who have studied humans but never lived as one, and you know who I'm talking about, hopefully, right? They, I think, will always struggle with understanding like the dark fantasy people. But let's say the way, well, how does a 2 differ from like a 5 in experiencing dark fantasy? Well, when I was a 2, as an example, and that's most of the population for people who don't know what I'm talking about, links down below for the 2 videos on the levels, one in-depth, one just a basic rundown. A number 2 is just basically most people in the world, people who live in the same bubbles they grew up in, understand the bubbles they grew up in, live in bubbles they are in, and think like, this is it, right? This is the height, I've reached the ceiling. 5s are people who have usually been well-traveled / met a lot of people, often people like me who have an opportunity to literally talk to thousands of people. So I know constantly my bubbles, my ideas of the world are being shattered. Because I'm reading about a lot of people who have lived or talking to a lot of people who have lived experiences, it's always being shattered. A 2 understands their existence within the bubble they're raised in, okay? Oh my God. So a 2 might look at BDSM and think, oh, I'm in BDSM because I'm completely normal. This has nothing to do with my traumas, and I just love being here. Another 2 might think, well, you're in BDSM because you've been fucked royally by the system, and you're fucked up, and you're only, you know, you only like this thing because you're, you know, a slave to the white cis man's pastime. Because, you know, a lot of people have criticisms about BDSM being a white person pastime, which is sort of true because it is a pastime of pleasure. So communities like immigrant communities, maybe like my family, didn't necessarily have the luxury of having a pastime as hedonistic as BDSM. But I will say, and I know that's ironic, some people don't think BDSM is hedonistic, but come on, you're doing things for pleasure and self-gratification, whatever, same thing. That's what I'm saying. The 2s think it's like this deep notion of like their ideas are like these deep, profound things, but you're still only viewing your life and your existence on the information you know in your bubbles. So 5 would examine BDSM as a possibility of all the avenues. Maybe you are there because you're fucked up. Maybe you are there because you're not fucked up. Maybe you're there because you're a woman or a man, or you have these fantasies. Or maybe you're there because your mom was into BDSM. Or maybe you're there because you heard someone talk about it and it sounded good. Maybe you're there because you're not BDSM at all. It's the idea that a person who understands everyone is there for a different reason and a specific reason also understands that you cannot just like lump people into boxes, while being able to examine that all of us fit into specific boxes. But it's not the same boxes that the 2s have. Like the 2s will say, if you're in BDSM, you're either fucked up or you're a normal person who's like weird a little bit. And a 5 will say, you're probably in BDSM because your life, for whatever reason, brought you here. But the why of that isn't, I don't know that yet just because you're at the dungeon. I have to ask you and get to know you. Like, I examine people, like, for a living at this point, right? Like, I examine pop culture. We're about to do a whole series on media in the levels, referencing who's a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 in relation to media, so it's more digestible. And one of the things I've noticed is that I just want to make this clear for everyone listening. I'm not telling you I can read minds. I'm not telling you 5s are these all-knowing people. I'm not telling you any of that. I'm just telling you people who are 5s, according to my philosophy, are people who are truly able to see the individual, like truly able to see Jay as an individual. So Jay in this book is a serial killer who specifically go after twink gays, and he specifically rapes them, cuts them up into pieces, and then eats them. Okay. And I'm saying I can understand how Jay is an individual and Jay ended up fucked up. And what I'm saying is not to justify Jay. I'm not saying he's a good person. I'm not making a judgment call on Jay. I'm saying I am not shocked by Jay's existence. I think Jay's existence makes perfect sense. I think the world's existence makes sense. That's the problem. Everyone gets upset about passion issues, right? Like right now, BDSMers and gay people are all debating over who should go to Pride. And these are such shallow and limited ideas of our existences. But it makes so much sense, because if this is all they know, then this is all they can make important. This is all they can surround their life about and with. But when you're examining the world outside of it, you're experiencing so many other parts at the same time. So when you're into dark fantasy, if you're just into it because like you were fucked as a kid and you want to express it through art, that's great, my homie. But what happens when you haven't been fucked as a kid and you're still expressing this sort of art through your own understanding of it? Does that mean you're coming from a place of not a lived experience and so it's shallow? Or is it somebody else who's connecting to different parts of it for different reasons? I think people forget, like, I've never been an addict, right? I've never been addicted to drug use. But as I look and study drug addicts, there is a story there that I almost desire to tell sometimes because it's just such a interesting story. It's not drugs per se, actually, that I think is interesting. I think it's addiction in general that I think is interesting. This idea that people can become addicted to, like, being a revolving door is interesting. I've seen it with sex. I've seen it with porn. I've seen it with drugs. And because I don't experience it, I do want to explore more. So sometimes I think we forget that people who want to explore these dark fantasies could be people who have never experienced it, and that's why they're obsessed with it. Like, one of the reasons why I love watching certain famous people operate through the world is because I'm waiting to see if some of them have been able to balance finding, like, enlightenment with being famous. Because I think it's really difficult. I think it's extremely difficult. I think the world of fame is there to stunt you. Because it's a world in and of itself. It's a number two world in and of itself. It's mostly two A's or two B's. But seriously, it is that world, that bubble. Like, people think Hollywood or being a liberal elite or going to college or academia makes you more aware of the world, but it just puts you in different bubbles. So one of the reasons why I'm not very impressed with people who are like, I did this thing. I'm like, great. That sounds great for your bubble and to the extent in which you've reached this thing. But for them to think I overall respect it is interesting. Now, I understand people look at me and, you know, people, they're always leaving me comments about, oh, you know, you dress a little young, or you're not going to attract the right partners this way. And the irony, of course, is that I literally will never date anyone who does not see sex and dark fantasy the way I do. I will never be with somebody who does not understand how to respectfully objectify somebody and humanize them at the same time. If you're a person who literally cannot tell the difference between, you know, the different kinds of naked people in the world, or the different kinds of naked movements, or the different kinds of naked philosophy, and you just think naked people are all the same, like, we're never going to get married anyways. I don't know why anyone's holding their breath. Like, I need somebody who really understands. I try to see everyone as a complete individual, not in a Randian way, not separate from their life. On the contrary, in relation to their life, who are you and why did you end up this way? Your life informed you this way, not out of ignorance, though. I mean, your life literally is giving you these options, but there's so much more. And whether or not you go for it is on you. The reason ones exist in my philosophy system, this idea that people can be completely useless, but they don't even know that they're this useless, is because you know you meet those humans. You know those humans in life that are literally the burden for everybody. And for some of us, we keep them around because we love them and we're trying to understand them. For some of us, we have to block them out and not let them in our life. But they're always our vampire, energy vampires. There's always drains on society. They look a particular way. They act a particular way. They are people who are just completely self-sabotaging. People often mistake twos for ones, though, because they think being a one makes you a bad person. Not necessarily. It just makes you a useless one, which in some ways you could say bad. But I mean more or less like ones aren't necessarily always people who hurt other people directly, but they do hurt people. It's just sometimes hard to tell. Remember when I told the story about the tinfoil lady? One of you reached out to me and was very concerned about why I made her a one, which from a two's perspective seems really reasonable, right? Because you're looking at her, you're like, well, she's not really hurting anyone. But this is a woman who abandoned her family, didn't talk to her kids, didn't pay taxes, was not a participant in society, lived completely for herself. And then she went around believing things that were completely not real, right? Like, she basically believes in conspiracy theories to the point where it's ruining her life. She's hurt her family. She's not an active mother. They want her in her life, but they can't keep her there. She's the one, the person in her children's life that they've said, Mom, we love you, but we have to keep a distance from you. The way she explained her relationship with her kids to me, and again, remember, I am a person who talks to strangers on purpose. Even if it exhausts me sometimes, I do it because I know they're going to teach me something, and I know I'm going to teach them something, and it's such a cool experience to have. So this woman and I, in the middle of a road trip I was having by myself around the States, met up and had this conversation. but she's still a one. Regardless of how nice she was to me and wonderful, her ability to function as a human was so limited by her inability to process anything outside her bubble. In a way that made her even alienate herself from twos, normal people. If you're so different and so alienated that basically the world can't even understand you basically, I think there's a problem. I've never struggled with the world knowing basically who I am. I'm a loudmouth Middle Eastern girl who's queer and BDSM and comfortable with her body and gone on a journey. And I'm just like on her doing her thing on YouTube, right? Like, I'm pretty basic. I read Harry Potter. I like books. I watch movies. You know, I'm a basic person. There's nothing about my life that seems truly abnormal until you get to really know me. And this lady, right away, you knew she was off. You knew when you looked at her, you're like, something is off about you. And these are the indicators that are subtle but necessary to notice, especially when you're involved in dark fantasy. Especially if you're in BDSM. If you meet someone in the dungeon, it's going to be very subtle what parts of them are actually like number one and number two. I've met a lot of number ones at the dungeon. I've dated number ones. I've been involved with number ones. I've seen number ones in my life. And they were very hard for me to distinguish between the twos. I struggled so much because I kept trying to help them. And what I didn't understand is like they are literally unhelpable in any capacity because they're so damaged by their own like neuroses, like their own self-sabotaging neuroses, that they can't get better. And as I've said on this channel, as my therapist said to me, as Jordan Peterson says to his patients, you have to save yourself. Any good therapist will tell you the world cannot save you. You keep trying to appeal to the world. It's going to destroy you. You need to save yourself. And so you learn by being a good person, right? Like what that means and having a value system, how to distinguish, hopefully, the differences between people who are seriously going to murder you and people who are going to pretend to murder you. I remember I was dating someone and he had this fantasy of doing like a kidnapping scene with me. And I could never, it's a hard limit of mine. I can't do them. I would have to feel so safe in this scene that it would just take a lot of work. And though I love my partner at the time and everything, I didn't trust him to understand how bad my PTSD was with my assault. And at the time, he wouldn't have understood because at the time we had originally negotiated this, I hadn't told him, which is a mistake I know now. In the future, I'm very open that I've been assaulted. I'm open that I've had PTSD or that I have PTSD, but it's in remission or whatever you want to say. I'm not sure with PTSD what language to use, but I don't get the same triggers, but it could happen. So at the time, I was really like, I couldn't even admit it to myself. Like, I kept my assaults a secret for like 8 years. I just like didn't want to talk about it. I didn't want to admit to it. And then finally, in the middle of sex with my partner at the time, I got triggered and I started to yell the things that I was thinking in my head out loud. And he realized like, oh, this is turning into what we thought was a consensual CNC scene to an actual trigger. And because he didn't know that I had, and I didn't know I, because I wasn't diagnosed at the time, didn't know I even had PTSD, but he didn't know I had been assaulted. It was just even more confusing for everyone in that moment. But either way, so this one time we were trying to negotiate a kidnapping scene, and I couldn't explain to him at the time why it really would fuck with me. But what I tried to explain to him was this, that I would go into survival mode and that I would try to kill you. And he's like, what do you mean? I was like, if we did a scene that was as convincing as I need my scenes to be when we do them, then I would have a moment where I would doubt this was really you. And I would think it was some crazy coincidence and I'm actually being kidnapped. And then I would try my best to literally fight you and do whatever it took to kill you, or I would die in the process. I'm never again going to be a fucking victim of anyone's power. Like, the first time I was assaulted, I didn't fight back. I wanted to die. It was a mistake. I know now for next time that I will fight back and I will make a stand, right? And so that means I've had to train my brain to get ready to fight. So here I am taking self-defense classes and doing all these things. And then my man at the time wants to do a kidnapping scene. I'm like, girl, you want to die? So I was like, no. So we came up with all these scenarios to try to figure out if we could make it work. Like, he was like, oh, I'll wear a cologne, you know it's mine. I'll whisper a safe word into your ear so you know it's me. I'll do all these things. But at the same time, he was talking about in all the ways he would change his appearance, change the way his facial hair felt, so I would doubt it was him. So it's, again, when you're playing with these fantasies, you want to get as close to the real thing as possible to sort of experiencing it like a drug, like a good trip. You want to get really fucked up so you're having like a moment, but you know in the back of your subconscious like, oh, girl, you're going to be fine because you negotiated for this. But to do that, you have to have a really safe environment and really trusting environment. And then you have to go into it. So that's why I don't play often with many people. That's why I've been very content and happy not involving myself with anyone for the last 2 years. Because for me, like, I'm looking for a very specific person, a person that totes the line between being able to tell the difference between a deep desire someone wants to role play and a possibly self-destructive person that wants to put themselves in a situation where something bad happens to them so they can have a story, slash a person that wants to be harmful towards another person in guise or in lieu or in while pretending to be a BDSM person. You know what I mean? There are so many illusions, so many beliefs we have and tell ourselves over and over again, like, the world is safe, the world is safe, the world is awful, the world is awful. It's not that simple. The world is a safe and awful place. The world is very safe if you know how to navigate it. The world is very dangerous if you don't. That's why you have to be street smart. It's why you have to kind of go out there. But how do you gain street smartness? Well, a big part of it, to be honest, is getting hurt. But you can't get hurt on purpose because that's self-destructive and stupid, and you will not learn a lesson there. You will just learn you're stupid. Don't be stupid, stupid. Like, actually, put yourself in situations that you've calculated to the best of your ability to be safe, and then recognize that it might not end up safe. And in the same vein, I think people, especially people who are fives or along their journey to become a five, are given opportunities in which they make decisions to play with fire while recognizing they could get hurt and being able to deal with that. I think the struggle I have, and it's not just fives who can do this, like, I think if you're on your way to a five, it's very specific. I think a lot of humans will also make the mistake, and this is why some of my friends told me not even to share the level system, because some people will be like, well, I want to be a five, which is actually very common in human brains to want the next best thing. So they'll think, oh, I need to be a five. So I'll start fucking with people that are dangerous. Maybe I'll go on Craigslist and answer an ad for a rape scene. And I'm sitting here like, home skillet, you are just a one in disguise. Or a two who's who's delusional. Because in order to reach a five, you have to be self-aware enough to know not to be reckless, but to also acknowledge life can be reckless. I know this sounds very like woo-woo or very not clear, but that's the whole point as well. How can I explain to the world you should not seek out dangerous people while recognizing that in my life I have put myself in dangerous situations? You know what I mean? And I, you know, in some part of my existence, continue to do so. Some people would say, as an example, like Marcus, you know, Marcus, he works on my brother's farm right now. Love it. And Marcus goes walking in the middle of the woods where we have bears and wolves, and he takes his dog with him. Yes. And he has like weapons on him, but not a gun. And it's funny because a lot of people are like, oh, he's still playing with fire. He shouldn't go alone. But Marcus doesn't want to stop living his life. So in some ways, I commend him for going out there alone. But to be honest, I couldn't personally do it. Not really. I did travel a lot by myself in national forests, and I did take risks of being surrounded by bears, but not the same risk he's taking, because I had a vehicle. I had a cell phone that had like an emergency number on it. I'm not sure he has that hooked up. I had an ability to jump into my car. I just never left any place that I couldn't get away from the bear. But Marcus full on puts himself out there. And I commend him for that. I love that about him. But if anyone else did it who wasn't Marcus, I'd be like, don't be reckless. And the reason I say that is because Marcus, if he dies from this bear, he's not going to be upset. He's going to be upset, but he's not going to be upset. You remember the grizzly man, the man who went to Alaska to chill with Alaskan grizzly bears? A lot of people think he's stupid. But I think he is, I think he might have been super, like a five, maybe. I just love him so much because he really sees what I see what he sees. When he talks about like the bears he made friends with had human eyes, I see that in animals. I see that in humans. When he says the bear who ate him, and you can see him on camera, isn't liking him, the bear who ate him looks like a bear, like a wild animal. And humans have that too. And this is what I'm trying to tell people. If you don't understand that humans and bears, like, we're all just an animal species, humans, there are people you look at in the eye and they are just animals. And if you've never seen a person look at you and you get chills down to your very core because you know this is an honestly dangerous person, like honestly, then you have not had the experience that I've had or other people have had, where when you look at that person, you're like, oh, that's it. And I'm not talking about in the super two way. Like, you know how these people freaked out over like the Nazis and everything. And I was there too. I was a two at the time and I was like freaking out. And then I started to meet some of these people and I'm like, y'all are dumb as rocks. You're a bunch of scared people in khaki pants. Like I could beat them up, I'm pretty sure. But not literally, just like I could basically like out beat them up verbally. But the thing that's interesting about it is like, I'm not afraid of those people automatically because they're rolling with really stupid ideas. Because I know humans and I know when I look at them in the eye, whether or not they're truly going to be murdered dangerous. Truly. Pushing boundaries dangerous now? That's different. I think people are pushing boundaries in different ways. So I'm not yet equipped to always handle or predict whether or not a person will naturally push boundaries. But I can say that I have a feeling, oh, there might be someone who pushes boundaries. But it's not necessarily predatory. I think people have to understand, like to be my friend as an example, I will demand at certain points that you push your own boundaries. I will demand you grow. I will demand it. Because I will tell you, hey, you've been calling me about the same problem for the last 2 years. I'm over it. It obviously isn't getting better. Try a different method. Like, try a different fucking method. And that's only my inner circle. That is not people who, that I'm friends with casually, not people that are in my life casually. And if you come to me, I'll tell you. But my inner circle, like, I only let them fuck around for so long before I'm like, hey, you know you're fucking up your life, right? And I expect them to do that with me as well. My siblings, I'm so lucky to have them because I go to them for even my own work. Like I say, hey guys, I want to talk about James Franco. We all love James Franco in this house. I have been working with them to pass ideas back and forth with me over James Franco because I'm so excited about this thing I'm going to do about him. But so much of him, the facade of him, I guess, is such a good example of like, do we know what we're looking at? Do we honestly know if this is a predator or not a predator? How do you know these things? Well, how do you know if you're never going to meet this person? That's the next part of this. When you meet people online and you see they're into dark fantasy, how do you know that the people you're talking to are actually just genuinely into this thing you're into and aren't creepy? One of the reasons I hate foot fetish people, foot kink people, is they're so obnoxious. You all start off your conversation so intimate. You start right away with your kinks and fetishes. So much disrespect. No consideration for the person you're talking to. I've had these interactions with you guys. You drive me all crazy. And it's so funny because this is why I don't belong to communities, because I don't want these communities representing what I'm into. I'm into feet, girl. I'm into feet in different ways, though. All about that humiliation. All about that, you know, humbleness that comes in, the humility that comes in with these sort of scenes. But I don't fuck with most people who claim they're into feet because they're often really fucking crazy. And I say that because you all are so disrespectful. I've seen your messages on FetLife. I've seen your messages on my OnlyFans. I've seen your messages on my Patreon. And it's all of you. Like, I'm so shocked that so many people who like the same thing could, for the most part, just be so unrelatable. Like, they're just so, I don't relate to these people. Maybe because I'm a woman and these are all men, but like, as a woman, I've just never DM'd someone my fantasy right away. I've never just started off with, yo, I'm into feet. Who talks to people that way except people who are selfish and just focused on their own fucking fantasies? Who wants to trust a person like that? Why would someone trust you? Like, we can't even trust you to hold a normal conversation and you want us to trust you in bed? Crazy. That's crazy, right? But they don't even see themselves that way. They say, well, I'm in a kink space, so I should be able just to be my kinky self. Sort of. But like, kinky people are also people. So you might want to learn to treat people like humans. So, okay. Blah, 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 blah. Okay, I need a little bit of a break just to recharge, and I'll get back on this with you guys in just a second.
Hi, hello. Are you a loser who spends all their time on the computer pondering their own existence?
Me too.
Join us on Patreon for just $1 to meet hundreds of people who are exactly like you, or nothing like you, or somewhat like you. On Patreon for just $1, you'll have access to live shows, collaborations, and conversations. Oh, and of course, photo shoots of me looking like a hoe. So join us there and enjoy the ride. Thanks. Bye.
All right, I needed a little break there. I am like sweating tits in this outfit. I'm not gonna lie. So much about like fat fashion is like, how much am I gonna sweat in this? That's what I'll say about BDSM dungeons. The good thing is like, you might show up in all this leather and get sweaty and disgusting, but at least you can take it off by the end of the night. Especially when it comes to latex. Oh my gosh, the amount of sweat that has been produced because of latex on my body is just amazing. I want more latex. That's something else I want to dive into. Sorry, tangent. Want to dive into more latex in my life. Okay, so where do we go from here, guys? I have loved the way this podcast has gone. I hope it's going good for you guys. And I want more than anything for people who especially feel alienated from the world to find a place. I think a lot of us, though, describe safe spaces differently. I think we're all different people. And the last thing I want to do is dehumanize you by assuming you're like me. And I ask that you do the same to me. Do not assume I've had your life or that we're the same. We have things that are similar about us, but we are all very different people. One of the things I love about having so many BDSM friends or people who do BDSM is that we're all there for completely different reasons. You know, I talk about how much I use meditation and spiritualism within my BDSM. I do that with everything in my life. One of the ways that makes me sort of annoying to try to go on a date with is that I am a person who, like, gets to the point, but I also am looking for a very weird person. And a lot of the time when we're exploring dark fantasies, we are thinking of the romance of it, the longevity of it. So for me, just to share with you guys, because, you know, I've had relationships public before. I'm definitely not going to do that again. But a big thing about my relationships that are significantly different to me than my friendships is that exploration into dark fantasy, because it allows vulnerability. I've talked about it a few times over the last few weeks, just why I cannot be my truly authentic self all the time with everyone. I need to do it in different layers. Like my friend, my best friend of 20 years, who's coming out this weekend to chill with me, we know each other so fucking well. So well. Like, could make decisions for each other, could, you know, order food for each other. We're very similar people. Not similar people. We just know each other very well. And because of that, you know, we can feel very safe with each other, but still cannot confide in each other in the ways we would like to with lovers. You know, we've both had adult relationships. We're both currently single. We've both, you know, in our 30s now. And we're both from a very different a time in America, in a very different suburb. And so we have a very different idea of romance. And we both want different things. But what we want ultimately is a person who is like us or sees the world like us. And that means for me, somebody who sees the darkness and the light in everything. Someone who's, you know, into sex and loves sex and feels comfortable in their body. Someone who's already worked on their vulnerabilities of being naked. Someone who's working on them. Someone who's interested in that. You know, when people try to give me advice, when my mother tells me, I hope you end up with a nice Catholic man, and I try to explain to her how miserable I will make that man, it's not because I'm trying to stay only in the fantasy world. Because many of you guys know, I don't want to raise my kids in the fantasy world. I want my kids to be raised in mostly traditional ways with an understanding of how the world works so they know what rules to break when they get older. I think it is very good to understand how the world works first and then to understand how to play around with it and find the loopholes. Because if I don't want to raise my kids thinking, hey, you know how weird your mom is? Everyone's that weird, because they're not. Your mom is much more accepting of people and tolerant of everyone than most people. I'm an extremely tolerant person, and because of that, I think it's a blessing and a curse. I'm tolerant because I'm curious, which means I invite people into my life that I don't even know necessarily that I would agree with, but I want to know why they think that way. So I'm like enamored with them. So I just want to figure it out. And then sometimes I go, okay, thanks, I figured it out, bye. In other ways, I'm very black and white with my own life. My children will see their mother being her weird self, and I do not want them to think that's how the world is, because it's not. And so I want them to have a preparedness. But how do I, as a weird person, go and try to find people like me? Well, I have a video coming up on this about dating online and what it was like for me. I know my person's definitely not on a dating app because that's just not my area. I'm not supposed to be there. I don't like it. And it's for very basic reasons, right? Great experience being on the app. Just it invites certain kinds of people there. And I had to explain way too many times what BDSM was, who Poppy Z Bright was, what dark fantasy was, to ever feel like this is my crowd, right? And so I have to do it by eliminating people, by going on dates, by putting myself out there, by taking time. And it is exhausting. Dating is exhausting. So I date actively through my work. I don't know if you've noticed, but I am putting myself out there. I'm making it clear who I am. I'm being as transparent as I can on the internet so I don't attract the wrong people. And yet, I do attract a lot of people that are almost right for me, which is interesting. Because how do you know the distinguishing difference between who's right for you and who's almost right for you? And for me, it's the way they understand where I'm coming from, and it's the look they give me when they look at me. I get very distinct looks from people. People who often look at me like they admire me, because they do, and that's very sweet, and I'm honored, and I completely feel like as Mama Simon, as like your mom, I love that. So some people look at me like I'm their mom, and I do love it. I think it's wonderful. Some people look at me like I'm a big sis. Love that too. Some people look at me like I must have you, and those people I don't like. Some people look at me with question in their eyes, like, what are you doing? And I'm like, I don't know, what are you doing? And those people are the greatest. They make, so far, great friends. And then other people see me as this, like, how do I say this? Like, too good to be true. And then they get to know me and they're like, oh, I see now. So this is interesting. Like, recently I was talking to somebody and, like, we looked so good on paper together. But when it came down to it, the thing that was heavily missing was, like, this component completely connected to my mental illnesses and the dark side of my brain. Sex is really cool. And in BDSM porn, they push a lot of that the fantasy is the action. And I think the fantasy is the psychology. So what I'm looking for in a person is the person who can go down the psychological route, the route of the dark fantasy, not just the physicality of it, while still maintaining an understanding that it's not real. This is very hard to find. It is very hard to find a person that knows enough about monsters to not be one, versus finding someone who knows too much about monsters because they are one. But at the same time, in order to know monsters well enough, it's not that you have to become one, but a part of you distinctly has to be created to be your monster part. Does that make sense? Like, you know when you meet people who are like, oh, I love Beetlejuice, I love goth, I love all these things that are dark and seedy, but then you get with them and their life doesn't reflect that? That's fine. I think that's normal and common, and I think it's great. And then you meet people that are definitely in that lifestyle, and then they sacrifice cats, and you're like, okay, too far, right? I want someone right in the middle, please, who, again, can go down this route, but isn't this route, okay? I feel like there's a middle ground. And actually, Scott Adams was talking about this, the creator of Dilbert, on his live show about how women are 40% more likely to have, like, depression, and they're experiencing a lot of identity issues right now. And I don't think that's abnormal. I think women are really struggling with how to be independent people who own and have agency, and balancing that attraction they have to their partners, in which they want to explore very opposite of that fantasies where they are submissive. Or if we've seen with Gen Z women, a lot of them are talking about how they don't want careers, they don't want to hustle or be a slave to the man, i.e. proving anti-feminist correct, that women don't want to be CEOs and they don't want to work. Like, I don't know how else to tell you guys this, but I think there is a denial of our nature and a lack of embracing the individual. I am a woman, as an example, who loves to work, will continue to work. I love my job. But I also know ultimately I want to be a stay-at-home mom. I want to be a wife. I am a submissive. I am a dominant person and personality. Like, look at me, aggressive. You want to fuck with me? You want to try? But when it comes to my personal relationships, I don't want to be in charge all the time. I don't have it in me. But I know men, for whatever reason, gain great satisfaction out of being needed and being a head of household. And so as long as they actually do respect me as an equal, I'm more than happy to trust them with these things. As long as they are a person that is, you know, compatible and all that stuff. But I think people have a hard time with that because they think it's like, oh, you're giving away your feminist card. It's fine. I'm not feminist, so I don't have a card. I left feminism because it kept telling me how to live my life. And I don't want that. I don't want anyone to tell any of us how to live our lives unless we ask or unless we want something different to happen. My therapist told me to seek out my joy no matter what it looked like. And I ended up in a place I never thought I would live, surrounded by people I never thought I'd live by. And I love it. And I'm in paradise and I'm blessed. And people call me crazy all the time. Like, girl, how do you live here? There's not even a mall. And I'm like, girl, how do you live with where you live where there's a mall everywhere? How do you find quiet? How do you hear your own thoughts? How do you know who you are if you're constantly always surrounded by people? And at the same time, like, girl, I miss BDSM dungeons more than I miss anything. I miss being in a just dark, seedy dungeon full of sweaty bodies I don't know, hands all over me I don't know. And I love, oh God, I miss it so much. I miss going into a gay club where people just touch you and everything's just what it is and it feels what it is. And you can just have a moment. I miss that. I don't think we'll get it back anytime soon. And I'm just going to have to create my own little dungeons or something. But man, I really miss just feeling alive with other people. I feel alive all the time here in my inner circle. I'm in, like, literally paradise. But I mean in the world. And I think sometimes feeling alive in the world also has to do with being just a number in a crowd. people are so obsessed with like standing out when they're amongst a crowd. But when I'm at the BDSM dungeon, I love not talking. I love just being there and being around people and being somebody that doesn't want attention. Maybe because my job is all about the attention, that I'm sick of it. Like, I don't love it. You guys know, like, even at my own wedding, I don't want to walk down the aisle because I don't want that much attention on me. I don't like it. It's a fantasy. It's not one of my fantasies. It's just not one of my fantasies of like, oh, I'm going to be a beautiful bride. And I just want a very simple backyard wedding with my friends and family in a potluck. So it's chill. I don't want anyone to feel pressured. I don't want bridesmaids or groomsmen. Like, everything about me is just very specific to the way that I see the world. But it's very unlike other people. Guys, most people dream about their wedding day and getting their wedding dress and having bridesmaids. I mean, I don't want any of that. It just doesn't seem interesting to me. It seems like a waste of money and a lot of pressure. And it just doesn't seem fun. Like, I want a fun wedding. Just like casual barbecue fun, you know. I don't need a hardcore BDSM wedding, though. I'm not gonna lie, I'm gonna do a BDSM wedding probably privately, because BDSM has its own ceremony for like collaring. So it's just kind of funny. Like, did you see Kat Von D's wedding? You know how Kat Von D's like one of those people? I think she's a truly unique person, Kat Von D. I think she's very much living her own life. I think she's genuinely struggled and really had to fight her demons. And I think her wedding is a great example of like what I imagine Kat Von D's wedding to be like. But see, Kat's like a goth princess, yo. And that's beautiful for her. I feel that. I almost want that in my head, but I don't want it in real life. And that's a struggle. When you want the dark fantasies in your private intimacy life, and like with your partner, I don't mean sex. I mean just when you're alone. And then, but your life looks vanilla or looks normal on the outside. It's like a very big struggle. But that's how I am. I'm like a really normal person. I think this is normal. Like, it's a little weird to wear a harness. But I also think I look pretty normal today. Go check out my Instagram for a full body pic of today's outfit. But I feel like I look normal because a lot of the punk kids are also using BDSM as fashion. So it doesn't make me stand out as much. But I know that I stand out in like a conservative town. So I think it's a mixture of like knowing where you are, knowing who you are, what you look like, how you're perceived, and so on and so forth. Okay, one last tick on this. Because people who look dark fantasy in the outside sometimes like are not on the inside, and that's interesting to me, and that's what I'm trying to say. But Alba and Preach did a video, they're YouTubers I really like, about people when they travel and how like how you're perceived is very important. And it's funny because when we talked about traveling, it made total sense. Like, be careful if you look too much like an American, people might want to rob you. Be careful if you look too rich, don't dress too rich, people will judge you based off this. That's the same for every part of life. If you dress BDSM, people are going to judge you that way. If you dress like kind of mismatched or whatever, people are going to judge you. If you dress super fancy, people are going to judge you. People are always judging each other because we're always trying to figure out who we're observing or looking at. And I know a lot of people don't even focus on that, but I want you to do that for yourself. This week's homework is to try to see yourself objectively, which I know is impossible. I've been trying to do it for the longest time. And I had a moment where I think I did it with shrooms. And I'm going to talk about microdosing with shrooms in a separate video next week. But something I noticed is that I've been trying to do this with weed, and I can almost do it. When I stare at myself really high in the mirror, I can almost see myself objectively. When you look at a person, automatically your brain goes, oh, he looks like a fuckboy. Oh, she looks like a slut. Oh, she looks really conservative. She looks like a virgin. Da 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 da. How do you look, and is it accurate to who you are? I've been trying really hard to try to see myself and try to see if it matches up with who I see myself as internally. And I have good friends who know me very well, so I can like ask them, hey, I found these pictures of these girls on the internet who look like me. Is that really what I look like? Same thing with your voice. You hear your voice a particular way, right? A friend just said this to me the other day. You hear your voice a particular way, but it's different to how other people hear it. Same with how you look. So that's what's interesting to me. You know what I mean? All right. I think that's it, guys. I think we did it. Oh my God. I think we did it. Thank you so much for being here. I'm pretty sure I've talked about everything I wanted to. I'm so excited. And just like, thank you for having these conversations with me. Put your comments down in the sections down below. Even if it's for the algorithm, it really, really helps. You know, I don't want to become famous. Don't do that to me. But I do want to become well-known enough that this is my job forever. And it puts me in a place where I can meet and continue talking to awesome people like you guys. So thank you for being a part of my freaking dream life. I appreciate it so much. And yeah, I'm going to go. Thanks for watching. Have a great day. I'll see you next video. Bye.
Stuck in my head, in real life while in bed, my belly's being fed and I'm okay. I'm just fine, yet all I do is whine, not to you in my mind. So why's my life a mess? Please tell me, cause I'm sick of thinking. Yeah, I'm sick of reaching out for the truth and living life as a fool. Dun, 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 dun.